I want to try to make a belt sander similar to this one, and I came up with a design for one in 2012, but I never got around to building it. And I went through some of my junk and I decided to use this 14 mm shaft for the main shaft because I have bearings that fit on there. And for the idler shaft, I figured I'd use this 3/8 shaft, or about 10 mm. Now, the drive wheel on one of these things ideally would have rubber on it, and for that, I bought this inner tube, which will hopefully be usable. Well, it turns out the rubber on the inside is a little bit thicker than the rest of the inner tube, so that kind of sucks. Here's a bicycle inner tube, a really thick one, and I just cut a piece off the end of that. And it looks like I can stretch that quite a bit, so maybe I can use this inner tube. The drive pulley is going to be 8 cm in diameter, so I'm just making a whole bunch of circles out of plywood that size. I'm going to glue all these together on the shaft, and to keep them from spinning, I want some kind of a keyway in there. So, first I'm going to mark where this comes to. Now I have to cut that cylinder perfectly round, which I could do by sanding or lathing, but instead I'll spin it over my table saw, just with a cordless drill. It's taking quite a bit of tweaking, but the shape I actually want is for this to have a bulge in the middle, and that'll help the belt track in the middle. It had been my plan to just stretch rubber over this in longer sections like this, but I found this is already too much to try to stretch over this. So instead, I'm going to try to coat this with silicone. The weird thing is, I didn't get any silicone on my hands. I made the idler drum the same way, except the discs are smaller and the shaft is also smaller. I also had to slightly modify my jig for rounding it because the diameter is smaller and the shaft was shorter. Let's see if I can get those pieces of inner tube on there. They still need quite a bit of stretching. Yeah, it's doable. I'm not sure if those ridges have much of an impact, but they're easy enough to cut off with a knife. Now that I have the rollers made, I printed some one-to-one drawings from the SketchUp model using my big print program. And I don't have all the dimensions on here, but all the ones that I didn't label, I can just measure straight off the drawing. These bearings are 32 mm outside diameter, which luckily makes for a tight fit in a 1¼-inch hole from this drill. So the important thing is to still have a way to get the bearing back out. So here's how this fits together. These two things form the sides, and then in here we have a cross brace that's here, and another one here, and then we have this piece here, and that's elevated a little bit. Fits underneath this part here, and then this part fits on top of here, and this is actually a little bit further up. And then there's this funny part which gets pulled on here and pushes this part out that way. And then we have the pieces here for mounting the bearings. And on top of all of that, we have this part here. And the backer for the belt goes on here. And of course the rollers are here and here. Before putting in the ball bearings, I drilled a couple of holes which allow me to push it back out. And I also drilled another smaller hole in here to make sure the inside part of the ball bearing won't be rubbing against the wood. The roller is about 3 millimeters higher than this piece of wood, which is about where I wanted it to be. This part goes on here, and that needs to be square. And looking at it, I can tell that it's not quite square. So. I start by drilling pilot holes for the screws. And then I drill a larger hole for the shank. And after that, I countersink them, and then I drive them in with the drill. This cross brace goes in right about here, and I'm just going to use the tips of the screws to mark where I need the pilot holes. I want to make sure I don't accidentally drill the pilot holes through the plywood, but this spacer is just perfect for that. Now there's a slight screw up here. I have a gap of about 1/4 millimeter here, and it sticks out here, so I'll have to trim that down a little bit on here and shim it on this side. When I need to trim off just a tiny bit, I'll often just push it against the stationary blade, and then when the blade spins, it cuts off a tiny bit. Now this part is going to go on here, but I'll attach that later. And then this part goes on here, and this goes on top of here like so. And there should be enough room in here for this to slide. And I've got that in here a bit tight, so I'll have to add a shim here. So I decided that I do need this part on here to figure out how the rest of it goes together. But to not wear out the screw threads too much, I'm using some screws that are shorter and smaller than the final ones, just to hold it together while I work things out. So here's the shim I made for here to compensate for the fact that this didn't have enough room to slide in here. And again, I'm using smaller, shorter screws because this is not the final assembly. The idler roller is going to mount here, and I'll make some wooden bearing blocks, and those will be attached to these pieces of plywood. I just cut out some wooden bearing blocks made out of lignum vitae, and I'm going to screw these in place before I drill the hole through them. The bearing blocks need to be mounted to this part here so that this roller is going to be about 3 millimeters above this surface. When I first put this together, I found the bearings very hard to turn, and so I put a 3/8-inch drill in there and just sort of spun it around while tilting it to the side, but it got caught, so now I have a huge hole right here But as it is, I'm just going to leave it like that. If those blocks wear out with this gash, I can always make new ones. Not now. This thing is supposed to be able to pivot a little bit to control the tracking, but to keep it from moving side to side like this, it's supposed to have this part fit in between here. But this is a little bit too wide right now, and plus I also need to cut that same profile into the thing that's the top of the sander. So I'll just do that while it's assembled on the bandsaw. The way that belt tensioning is supposed to work is I need something to push this out here, and for that I've got this sort of lever thing, and for now I'm just going to attach it with a screw. So that pushes out here like this, as long as something pulls on here. And for that, there's a threaded rod with a knob on it here, and a nut that goes here. And to keep that nut from spinning, I made this block that the nut fits into. To control the tracking, I need to control side to side here, which is with a threaded rod through here. And I think I'm just going to put a couple of T-nuts on here to push that one way or the other. And that turns out to be a bad idea because the prongs of the T-nuts get stuck on these edges here. So I made this funny shaped block of wood which holds the T-nut, and then that fits into the slot together with the T-nut, and it keeps it from spinning. Well, I think I'm ready to try this with a sanding belt. The shaft is 12 millimeters, but this hole is half an inch, and that makes for way too much play. But making a shim out of a pop bottle can get that to be a fairly snug fit. And I also drilled a hole for the set screw, so I should be able to lock that on. There's still quite a bit of work left to be done on this, including some sheet metal to go underneath the belt here. I am pretty confident now that this belt sander will actually work, but that's enough for this week now.